everybody. Welcome to another episode of Tree Talk in the Treehouse, in the rain, on a very cold and wet January afternoon. But I'm very pleased that a friend of mine and fellow colleague is here today to join us in the treehouse, Jo Barnard.
Oh,
welcome, Jo.
Thank you, my love. Lovely to be with you in the treehouse in the rain in January with our blankets round
us. Thank God. Now, Jo, how would you describe yourself?
I don't know.
What do you do, first of all?
What do I do?
Just so that people can just kind of link in with, get an idea.
Yes.
A rough idea to start with.
So, to kind of sum it up, I guess, I'm a holistic practitioner. I host meditation groups, teach Reiki. I've recently become a funeral celebrant.
Yeah.
So, really, I think most of my work is about healing and people and the journey.
Yeah.
And really holding space for people so that they can come and feel safe and unfold and discover more about themselves. That's how I'd really sum it up.
So personal development, sort of enabler.
teacher,
because that comes from the Reiki. I mean, you know, and I know you run, like as you say, regular meditation groups, and this is from your own home in South Woodham.
It is, yeah.
It's a clinic, isn't it, really? It is. A wellbeing clinic.
Yeah. Yep.
It's called U-Time.
U-Time, yeah. So it's a section of our home that's converted into a workspace, which is lovely.
How does that fit in with your family life?
It's something that I've had to really find a way that works for me. So I think, you know, often we're conditioned to do things that please other people or what's going to be in demand. And really, I've turned that around and I've, I guess, created a life that works for me and works around the needs of my family. And as my family grow and change, you know, that evolves organically.
Yeah. And also working from home, I don't know about you, but I mean, if you anything like me, but it's a discipline, isn't it, in itself?
It is. And I think we all need a certain amount of structure and we all need a certain amount of space.
Yeah.
And it's, again, getting that balance. But for me now, I see clients on a one-to-one basis on a Monday and a Monday evening. I hold groups on a Thursday evening. And I do other bits. Ad hoc.
Yeah. Now, just winding back a little bit to before you started all this, before you worked for yourself, because this is self-employment, yeah?
It is.
What were you doing? And what caused you to transition from where you were to where you are now? So working for others to working for yourself.
Yeah. So I worked. So I've worked for myself now for 10 years.
Yeah.
But prior to that, I worked in a marketing role for 15 years. And even though it was marketing, it was still very much around communication and people. It was internal communication, which was really finding out what mattered to people, filtering messages back and forward to the right audiences. So it's always been about people and communication. So I think probably the turning point in my life was having my children and realizing that actually I'd been working up to, you know, you get the home, you get your car, you meet someone, you maybe get married or have children or whatever, and it's almost like this linear conditioned way of thinking and being and living. And I reached that point where, to me, having children was going to be the pinnacle. And I had, you know, my first son Lewis, and absolutely adore him, love the bones of him, love both my boys to death, but it wasn't it. There was still something missing. I thought it was going to fill this and complete this picture.
Yeah.
But it didn't. And then the journey of really finding out who I was began to unfold. And it came from, as it often does, a low point of who am I?
Do you think that who am I question, when we pose it to ourselves, that for you, part of that is being a teacher, because I think being a teacher is a big role, isn't it? It's a calling.
I think for me, I'm not a fan of the word teacher. I love to share information. I love to learn and share. I think also, you know, as we can learn on an intellectual level, and often we need to learn on an intellectual level as a starting point. And even whether it's kind of, you know, through learning Reiki, it's still a structure, it's still a system, a way of being. But I think we learn these structures so that we can get our heads around something, but eventually we begin to, it's a bit like stabilizers on a bike. You begin to let go of what doesn't work, you begin to let go of the systems and start to be. And I think that's really where I find myself now, wanting to be more. And I think that enables me to allow others to be more. And so whether you call that teaching, or to me now it's about holding space, but just being there, being present.
I think we've said before about teaching, because I'm a teacher as well, and it's about living by example, isn't it, really?
It is, yeah.
Because we don't teach anybody anything. We can only just lead by or teach by example, by being who we are, our true authentic selves.
Exactly.
So this whole journey from working in a corporate environment to creating your own holistic environment in the home space, which is wonderful, isn't it, working from home, bringing people into your home. That's a trust thing to start with, isn't it? It's allowing that to happen, and also putting those boundaries in, I suppose, as well.
Of course, absolutely, yeah.
So what would you, how do you feel about that, about boundaries? What kind of boundaries do you put up?
Boundaries
is by fence. Sometimes
boundaries is something I've had to become very comfortable with.
Yeah,
I think particularly when you hold a large group of people, and people come in with different needs, and really we all come with our own story, and often that story is not real, and people love to tell their story. And for me, boundaries now is really about, you know, if I'm holding a group of say 12 people, and everyone has an opportunity to share something if they want to, you tend to get one or two people that just want to keep telling their stories.
Yeah.
And that keeps them stuck. And it's about putting up the boundary to say,
We've heard it all.
Yeah. And sometimes coming across as maybe quite harsh, or being brave enough for someone to think, because I think the more we allow people to tell that sad victim story. So really, boundaries, I guess, A, with time, you know, time boundaries, and B, with, you know, I'm not prepared to take your stuff on. It's not mine.
And also, it's about the other people that are in the group as well.
Yeah.
And it's about making sure that everybody gets their turn, their time to share.
Exactly.
In because I know through holding my own sort of groups, they're very intimate spiritual groups, aren't they? And you are actually facilitating a space for people to open up.
Yeah.
And it's an intimate space.
Yeah.
So they've got to feel safe and able to be able to express sometimes things that they've not been able to talk to anybody about.
Yeah, this comes up frequently, the amount of times that particularly women have said, I've never even said that to myself, let alone in a group or out loud, which is a beautiful thing. And of course, you want them to feel that they can convey that, but also, you know, rein in, you know, where things aren't healthy.
Yeah. So again, with this transition from working for others to working for yourself, and you've chosen to move into the holistic field, whereby, as you said in your own words, you're unfolding more and more sort of petals, you know, peeling more layers of the onion to reveal who you are, so that you can give your best to whoever's going to be in your groups. So it must be quite a spiritual journey for you. It's part of your spiritual journey, isn't it?
It is. I mean, the word spiritual now to me means surrender.
Mm.
It's letting go of control, letting go of beliefs, opinions, and making space for that unfolding to happen. Because if we cram our lives full of all these things, there is no space. And it, when I think in the last year, my life has changed significantly from that place of allowing, as opposed to I never would have planned that change.
Now, that's what I wanted to talk about as part of your journey, and something that's only really, like you say, has happened in the last, over the last year, is quite a big personal change in your own life, where you've been home educating your youngest son.
I have, yeah.
What can you tell everybody about that?
So I have two sons, and they're now 15 and 12. And Max, my youngest. So Lewis is, I'd say, very academic. Max is very creative. And Max is this bright little thing, this shiny thing that attracts, little children love him. Everyone loves him. He's got so many friends. He doesn't conform. He doesn't want to conform to the norm. He's got long hair. He doesn't want it cut. He wears different kind of laces in his shoes. And he doesn't want to be like anyone else.
Good for him. That's what I say.
Yeah, absolutely. The school system was just sucking that out of him. And that light was beginning to dim.
Individual uniqueness.
Yes, and to me that was like warning. I don't want this spark to be taken from him. And funnily enough, we had a reading together. I don't know if you remember, but you pulled a card at a time where it was kind of on my mind, and there was a woman and a boy and a cow, and you said that I feel you need to make a sacrifice here. And I just knew that it was about doing that now, taking on that role. And of course, every part of my mind wanted to say, well, you're not a school teacher, you don't know about the curriculum, he's going to be an outcast, or all of these conditioned fears.
I'm taking him away from his friends.
What's going to happen? But there was this beautiful, gentle voice inside of me that at every turn said, you can do this, it's okay, you can. And I just followed that. I didn't know how, I didn't know where to start, because once you're out of the system, you're out.
Really?
You're just like, okay, what do we do now then? And obviously gone from being pretty free in the day, or my time, to having Max with me all the time.
But
we've really made it work, and it's been a beautiful journey that we're taking together, and it's doing him the power of good. And he's still socializing all the time, he's playing all the sport in the world, I've really been able to see over this past, because it's coming up for a year now.
Is it really?
Yeah, I know, February. Last February. By really stepping back and watching what he loves, what he's good at, and really where he's...
Without any restrictions.
Yeah. The problem with Max is he was conforming at school. He was doing as he was told.
Yeah,
he was being
a
good boy. And it was just like squashing him down.
Suppressing him.
And now he's kind of...
Blossomed.
Yeah, absolutely.
That's great, isn't it?
Yeah. And one of the things that his football is his absolute... His love, which he does all the time, but also video editing has been the thing that he's had patience with, and his creativity is really coming through that. So that's something we're really encouraging.
That's great.
For him.
And technology, with the technology that there is nowadays, is the world's his oyster.
Exactly.
So he's good luck to Max. Power to Max.
Yeah, he's got his little YouTube channel, and he makes all his football skills videos.
Has he really?
Edits them all, and
excellent.
It's great.
Excellent. Now, that kind of connects in with the next thing that I want to bring up, your writing.
Mm.
And I know that you've written a couple of books, mm-hmm. and you've had them published.
Yes.
Okay, a meditation book. Mm-hmm. So we've got non-fiction there. We've got a novel that you wrote.
Yes.
And I know that you continue to write for your courses and your handouts and all that kind of thing. So write, and you've written articles for magazines.
Yeah.
Have you thought about writing any more books, or maybe writing something about Max?
Have you thought about writing anything about Max? Not at the moment. Last year I felt in the summer I really wanted to start another book, which I did, and that's kind of dwindled again. So again, I'm just going with it. I love writing meditations. I love, you know, writing stuff that I'm sharing in the group. Sometimes a poem will just come through. So I think the writing's always going to be there to some degree.
And the poems, I mean, that's poems. Really right brain, isn't it? That's really sort of inspired.
Definitely.
Work. I think poetry is inspired.
Yeah. I mean, I think a couple of months ago I was literally stirring a pot of pasta in this, you know, as you know, you're out walking the dogs or something and suddenly something will just come in. When you're making space, you're not trying to force anything.
And do you write these poems down and have you published any of them online or anything like that?
No.
No? But obviously it's helping with your creativity because haven't we got a picture here that you painted? Was that inspired by a poem or?
No,
it wasn't inspired. I'm going to move the teapot.
Oh, yes. Let's reveal our lady.
Reveal our lady.
So, this is quite interesting because it was in early November I had this image come into my mind and it was so strong I had to sketch it out. Now I haven't painted since I was at school and my dad was a very talented watercolour artist and I think he was so great that in my mind I couldn't compete or I couldn't be as good.
No comparison.
So so why bother?
Yeah.
Which is ridiculous, but it was just something that lay dormant, I suppose.
Yeah.
And I sketched this woman out. She is actually Mary Magdalene.
Is she?
And it was so strong, sketching alone wasn't enough. And I just had this need to paint. And in my mind again was like, I can't paint, I don't know where to start. And I just went with it and she appeared. And
she's
obviously naked, she has nothing to hide, she's serene, she's grounded to the earth, she's creating from her sacral chakra, she is connected strongly to spirit and she is being birthed. And I didn't really know what that was about, but once I'd painted her, she was on an easel and you know, we did, both have done the NaNoWriMo challenge, which is the novel writing.
30 days. 50,000 words. Hardcore. Hardcore writing.
Which we've both committed to.
We've both
and
done, yeah.
And I thought, you know what, if I can do that for writing, I'm going to do this for painting. So every day through November.
You did a painting?
I did a painting.
Excellent.
And it just, I think she was just unlocking.
She birthed all those paintings.
She did.
So you've got 30, a whole month's worth of paintings.
I have, yeah.
That started with her.
Yes.
Wow.
And
what have you done with them?
Well, quite a few of them are now on my wall, which, you know, that was a breakthrough. I had, you know, my dad's no longer with us. I had his paintings kind of scattered through the house, really. And it felt symbolic to actually take one of his paintings down and put one of mine up.
Oh, yeah.
Because actually, the day that he passed away, I went back to his house and one of his shirts was hanging in his room. And I took that shirt home and it's been in my wardrobe. And my dad was known for being inspired and getting paint all down his best shirt and not caring. And so every day I've painted, I've put his shirt on, got paint
really?
All down and he's covered in paint now.
Oh, wow.
And I felt that I've really, he's
it's a
been with me.
Sort of ritual.
Yeah.
And a connection
yes.
with your father.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. So it's been a really beautiful creative process.
Yeah.
Yeah, which I'm loving. And Max has also loved, can we do art today?
I bet he has. So yeah, fantastic.
A lot of it, I think, is permission, isn't it? Giving ourselves permission to
do what you want.
Something.
Yeah, exactly. To create what you want to create.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yes.
Yeah. So as well as your, this, you know, discovering, unlocking this other part of your creativity,
yeah.
You've also done something recently which is very close to your heart, isn't it, that you're hoping to expand on now?
Yes, the Celebrancy.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, for probably the last 5 years, every time I've been to a funeral, I've thought, one day, when I'm grown up, I'd quite like to be that person standing at the front, holding space, and really honouring this life. And, you know, we all know, we go to funerals, some are beautiful, and you come out and you feel, oh, that was part of the healing process, that was beautiful, and we've had the chance to breathe, and we've had the chance to laugh, and we've got the essence of that person, and we've come out somehow uplifted. And we've also been to funerals where we thought, who's this? And it was a couple of years ago, I went to a funeral, and I thought, I'm going to look into this now. And I looked up a few places that offered the training. And it's independent celebrancy, which means that whereas you have obviously your church funerals, and we know about humanists, which are not only non-religious but non-spiritual. So there is nothing spiritual can be mentioned in a humanist ceremony.
I didn't know that.
Yes.
Really?
It's not allowed.
So they're non-humans,
yeah.
Basically.
Well, I guess they're just on Earth and then gone.
Okay.
Whereas being an independent funeral celebrant means that I can go into the home and say, what do you want? If you're not part of a church, you know, community, what do you want for your loved one? Or maybe not loved one, you know, it's not always straightforward. So what do you want? Do you want a hymn? Do you want a prayer? Do you want a blessing? Do you want something that's non-spiritual? You know, what do you want? Do you want to celebrate the life? Do you want to wear bright clothes? Do you want to use it as a time to just, you know, mourn? What do you want? And in a way, it's great because it takes, again, the beliefs and the ego and all of that has to fall away when you go into a home and say, what do you want? It's not about what my opinion is or what I think the process is. It's what do you want?
And I would imagine that you'd have to have a great degree of empathy and compassion and a sense of occasion to be able to, because that's quite a skill, isn't it? It's quite a skill being able to handle a situation that you're walking into where, I mean, because grief is a very personal and a very powerful emotion, isn't it?
That
is very effective. It influences a lot of people and in many different ways.
In many different ways.
So, yeah, it's a real, I would imagine it's a real skill.
Yeah, because you may have, you know, the lady that taught us explained that she went to visit two women who had just lost their babies in the same circumstances. One was so grateful that she'd been pregnant and she was so wanted to celebrate this life and focused on gratitude, whereas another woman just kind of hid the whole time and held on to a baby.
Wasn't able to.
Yeah.
So now you're offering that as part of who you are and what you can do for people, which is lovely, isn't it?
Yeah, again, it's holding space in a different way and honouring that life. I'm going to carry out a ceremony for a friend whose baby passed before she gave birth to it, and I'm really hoping that, you know, as we do this ceremony together, although it was many years ago, that will bring some kind of healing.
Oh, that's lovely. So she's actually, how long ago was it?
It was nearly 18 years.
Right.
And it's still very, very much at the forefront of her mind.
She's not been able to process it or let go of it or accept it.
I think she has to a degree, but I think there's still something that can be healed.
Yes.
And so let's hope that, you know, we can work through it together and give a lovely ceremony that honours the life.
Because absolutely.
Even, yeah.
Yeah.
And honours the pain.
Yes.
And
yeah. And is able to move beyond that.
Exactly.
Move beyond the pain.
Yeah.
Okay, that's lovely, Jo. Mm. Any projects in the pipeline at the moment? I mean, apart from wanting to expand in this new direction a little bit, it's just branching off, isn't it, really? Just slightly.
It is.
You're still on that sort of, you're still going up that trunk.
Yeah.
From earth to...
It feels like it's just a gentle unfolding.
Yeah.
Major projects, not really what I feel, what I felt called to. So I offer meditation, but bringing in more, you know, circle work, goddess work, again, really that journey of self-discovery,
empowerment,
releasing the shame, you know, that women have carried. And also,
why do you think they've carried a lot of shame, women?
Well, I think when patriarchy, you know, came in, and the church, you know, women, witches, wise women were
vilified.
Shunned. Exactly. And very much squashed down. And I think we're very fortunate that we're now living in this time where feminism has enabled women to rise again. But I think that the whole squashing has affected men and women equally. And feminism has also brought a lot of rah with it, which it's had to, but it's kind of gone to the, in many ways, to the extreme. And I think now I feel it's time for this gentle empowerment, enabling women to let go of conditioning from the past, releasing that guilt and shame, which is from, you know, time gone by. It's not necessarily in this lifetime. And also encouraging men to do the same, because I think it's really the healing of our planet is going to come from the rising of the divine masculine and feminine together.
And healing ourselves.
And healing ourselves.
It has to start with that, doesn't it?
Absolutely, yeah. Because we can, you know, look to others to fulfill that void in us, but that's unhealthy. When we can heal ourselves and then come together, then we get, you know, then we can serve the world, can't we, with our gifts?
Yeah, absolutely.
From that space.
Certainly, I find that when I work with people, in the readings especially, what you're doing mostly is trying to allow somebody to look at themselves, you know, to find out where that small voice of you know, of their own wisdom is, opening up to their own intuition, and working from the inside out, because otherwise it's pointless starting from the outside.
Yeah.
You have to start from the inside.
Absolutely.
Don't you? And it's clearly, you know, your mission in life is to be able to enable people to do that. However that's going to happen, whether it's going to come through art, whether it's going to come through the groups that you hold, the courses that you run, the, you know, the therapies that you give, you know, because behind the back of all that is who you are, sharing what you can do for others.
Yeah.
And it's that, yeah, that very much kind of comes through in all your, you know, all the hats and skills that you've acquired and continue to acquire. Because obviously you can't stop now. You know, it's evolving, isn't it?
Yeah.
I mean, who knows what this year may hold for you?
Who knows?
Yeah. But it'll be interesting finding out,
Jo. Yes.
Where it all goes. Mm. Because it's clearly moving along, flowing nicely, and that you're in the flow.
Yeah. And that flow has only come from making the space.
Yeah.
Yeah. And surrendering to
That's
that.
Great. Mm. That's great. Where can people find out more about you?
Mm. Okay, so my website is jobarnard.co.uk.
Yeah.
So you can find out about the Celebrancy, if you want to get in touch with me, courses, one-to-one stuff. There's some online stuff that I offer as well. I'm on Facebook.
You're on other aspects of social media as well, Twitter and all that kind of thing.
I'm on Twitter, but I don't really use it to be honest. I'm a Facebooker.
So your Facebook is your main platform,
and share quite a lot of stuff on YouTube, but on Facebook I do a lot of live meditations and.
We're going to do a Facebook Live, aren't we?
We are.
Oh, we have to sort that out. I look forward to that.
Yes.
Yeah, because I haven't really mastered, well, I haven't done any yet. So, but anyway, yeah, that'd be great. We'll have to sort that out.
Yeah.
But thanks ever so much for joining me in the soggy treehouse. Although it's been quite dry.
We have kept
dry. You can hear the rain outside. Poor old Mark's getting wet outside filming it. You're right out there, Mark. But anyway, yeah, thanks for coming. And come back at some point.
Maybe this time next year.
Yeah, that'd be good, wouldn't it? Yeah. 12 months' time. Yeah. Next January. We'll put that in the diary.
Yes.
Okay. Thanks, Jo. And thank you for watching, everybody. And we'll see you next time in the treehouse for the next episode of Tree Talk, TTFN. Oh, you're right out there, Mark.